It was developed, as I said, by the Spanish in the 1600s. trumpet. Let me tell you something about the harp. I've got to stand up. You know how everybody figures that once they go to heaven, they're going to have harps everywhere. You know that story, don't you? Well, let me tell you the truth about that, ladies and gentlemen. When you go to heaven, I don't care whether you're a Christian, a Jew, a Muslim, or a Buddhist, there are going to be no harps waiting for you. And do you know why? The reason for that is that throughout all history, the harp has been constantly laid upon by religious folk. Now, what a lot of people don't realize is that the harp fell from absolute use in Europe from the beginning of the Christian era to the 11th or 12th century. It was banned by the Christian church because it was so closely associated with the pagan cults, you know, with the Roman and Grecian pagan cults, the mystery cults. So the harp disappeared totally from Europe in those centuries, except for one place, the imaginary Ireland. Ireland was the only place that managed to preserve the harp. So between 300, say, and the year 1100, no matter how many years is that, let's say 800 years or something, there were no harps because they were banned by the church. Now, in Persia, when Islam took over there, the same jolly thing happened. The harp was actually invented in Persia. It's called the changes. And the moment that Islam came in, what did they do? They destroyed every one of the harps, every one of the harps. A capital offence to play on the harp. This was mainly, again, because it's related so closely to the original pagan religions, and also because women were the predominant performers on the harp, so it had a double indemnity against it. Now, this went on. Oliver Cromwell, you all know who Oliver Cromwell is, you've heard of that man. That's got to be one of the most wicked men in history, Oliver Cromwell. When he came to power, he went to Ireland and he destroyed every harp in Ireland except three. Three survived him, all again in the name of religion. He did the same to the Welsh, and God only knows how many survived there, but in Wales, only three of them survived. He executed every single harpist he could get his hands on. They were all hanged. It was a capital offence. Now, that sounds awful, but moving forward, again, we get the Iberian Wars between France and Spain, at just the time of Napoleon. When the French came plundering through the Iberian Peninsula, what did they destroy? They didn't destroy guitars and castanets. They again destroyed harps, right? And again in the name of an invasion of... remember, Napoleonic France was agnostic. You know, they were anti-clerical, against the church, against deeply Catholic Spain. So right through its history, we get nothing except the destruction of the harp by religious bodies. So, ladies and gentlemen, do you think you're going to find a harp up there? Do you truly expect that you're going to find a harp in whichever heaven it is you go to? Now, I hope you go to heaven. I do hope you say there is a harp there, but make the most of it while you can. And the whole thing of harps with angels, you know, that was developed not because somebody once saw a harp in the hands of an angel, but because of Dante. We all know Alighiero, we all know Dante, the Divine Comedy. He was the first person in the third book of the Divine Comedy, which is called Paradiso, to put a harp in the hands of an angel in a vision that he records in there. And local artists in Italy were so taken with this image of an angel holding a pagan instrument like a harp that they started putting them in paintings and sculptures. And that's where it all came from. So nobody's actually seen an angel with a harp, ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you. It's all made up by Dante in the Divine Inferno, the Divine Comedy. So here's a piece, this is from the 20th century, the end of the 19th century, early 20th century. It's by Eric Satie, a man that you will have heard of quite a lot of his piano music. This is a piece called Nociens. It's taken from Gnosis in the Mediterranean. It's a beautiful, very, very delicate piece. Thank you. such you remember so extraordinary, except you gave a sort of single-handed gave birth to 20th century music, a wonderful, obscure and private man. Now, Plato, the next piece I'd like to play is going to medieval France. Now, the French were great players of the harp, and you remember the troubadours. The troubadours, when they traveled around, they had two instruments. One was the lute, which was very popular, the other was the harp that they carried with them. Now, the troubadours' harps were dismountable. They could take them to pieces. This piece came off, that piece came off, that piece came off. They were made of wire strings and stuff. But it was with these, it was the fact that these harps in the hands of the troubadours traveled throughout the breadth of Europe that the harp was restored to popularity. Because the French got them from the Irish in about the 11th century, and then the French took them down to Italy where the harp became very, very popular. So the poor old harp had to be reinstituted bit by bit throughout Europe. The piece I'm going to play now is by a Josquin du Pré, a very, very famous 14th century composer, who's a troubadour, a troubier composer. The music is called Parafuela, which is the Spanish for meaning for stringed instruments. Now, the reason the French music has a Spanish title is that the troubadours travelled all over the breadth of Europe, and every now and then they would pick up music in foreign countries. They kept the original names of them, despite the fact that they were playing in France. They always kept the reference, international reference. So the troubadours were sort of essentially the first international artists. So here, this is a beautiful piece from Josquin du Pré. Thank you. Over years since I've been giving concerts here, the first time I did a concert here was back in 1984 when the place opened. And a lot of customers came along then, and they're still coming to my concerts now. I don't know where the longevity comes from my audience, it's just extraordinary. There's some people who think, oh, they should be here 20 years ago. And they're still turning up, everyone that done this concert now. Ladies and gentlemen, if some of you happen to be amongst the numbers there, welcome, and I hope that you stay coming for another 20 years altogether. Now, what's that going to play? I'm going to play the numbers. I'm sorry, I don't know why I'm going to play this number list. There you go. Thank you.